So, products are in the middle of it. So, okay, so you just tell me. Perfect. That's what I like. I like paper loops. It's all new material. Because everything I say will sound good. Okay. Before we start, I want to point out that this is my website. And I'm making available these slides. You can access them. You can go to my website, which is mylastname.com, and click on academia and scroll down to IITGN. You can access this presentation and the recordings as you wish. So all my sessions will be in online as well. So take a moment to write this down if you want. Mylastname.com, academia, then IITGN. Alright? I'm about to press the button. Got that down? Alright, I'm pressing the button now, moving forward. The other announcement is I'm making two of my textbooks available for free to you to download on Amazon.com only between dates of May 22nd to May 26th. That's what Amazon allows me to do. Just go to I love a publishing company, some of you. yeah, and if that doesn't work, let me know. Because sometimes it doesn't translate from Amazon.com to Amazon.in. If that doesn't work, I will arrange for it to be given to you another way, perhaps even easily. So keep that in mind. Again, there are links to this from the same website. You can get there. Not everything that I say is covered in these books, but some of it is. Definitely the later presentation we're going to have on the global burden of disease is covered pretty thoroughly in that book, as well as some of the stuff that Denise talked about around demographic transition. Okay? Alright, let's begin. If the topic of research ethics interests you, the Canadian government actually has an online course you can take at this website here. And you go through the process, you take some exam questions, and you get a certification of the end. It's free, it's boring, it's long, you don't need to do it. My graduate students have to do it, we're part of them. If you want to do it, you can. But be sure to notice that it's relevant for Canadian research in particular, but the larger concepts are relevant to you as well. And again, you don't need to write that down because you just go to the website and download this. So that works. So let's begin with this picture here. This is a picture we took in Sri Lanka in 2004. So if you remember in 2004, there was a big tsunami, the Asian tsunami, that devastated much of India and much of Sri Lanka. And some friends and I opened an NGO as a result. And we sent relief to certain parts of Sri Lanka. And we actually sent a small team into a refugee camp in Sri Lanka to deal with orphan children. And our team, while they were there, decided to do a little research. They sent out a questionnaire to some of the orphan children. And we learned some fascinating things about them. Afterwards, I presented our findings at a hospital in Canada. And there's a big audience, everyone loved it. Afterwards, I got a nasty letter from the president of the hospital saying, we could find no record of you having received research ethics permission to do this thing. And it's true, we did not receive research ethics permission. We'd actually got permission from the Sri Lankan government, which was least okay. But the point being that people were watching carefully. Every time you deal with what's called a vulnerable population, it's important to make sure there's oversight ethically of what you're doing. So that's an example of me having failed in the process. It's okay. There's nothing illegal about it. It's just unethical. And I just learned from that process and gone forward. So when we talk about ethics, we're talking about a number of things. One definition of ethics that I like is ethics is a struggle to find a beneficial balance between the activities of the individual and the effects on the group. That's one of the definitions. I also like the definition of ethical behavior. This is a very useful one. Ethical behavior is when you are responsible for the foreseeable consequences of your actions. So, very often, the results of our actions are not foreseeable. If I want to do good, then I'm doing bad. That's unfortunate. Sometimes, though, that inability to foresee the consequences is a failure of our own thinking process and a failure of our educational process. That's not. So, keep this definition in mind as we go forward. What we're going to do this afternoon is I'm going to talk for 45 minutes, maybe an hour. Then, we're going to break up. We'll have a short break, and then I'll give another presentation about the specific case of ethics in India. And after that, we're going to have something resembling an interactive session. I'm going to show you some scenarios of research ethics, and I want you to identify the unethical aspects of the projects, and maybe try to figure out what the ethics boards found problematic about these scenarios. So hopefully it'll be a little fun. So, when we talk about research ethics, We can talk about all kinds of things. We can talk about whether or not it's ethical to publish in some journals rather than other journals. Some journals are not as ethical as other journals. We can talk about whether our data has integrity to it. Was it collected in an ethical fashion? Does it represent the truth as best we can gather? Are there conflicts of interest? We see this a lot in drug company research. So drug companies would sponsor clinical trials or test the efficacy of the drugs. But of course, it's in their best interest to make sure that those drugs work. Can we trust them? Is the process transparent? Do we know how they got their subject, how they did their analyses? Are the animals treated well? Occupied, we forget about the animal welfare when we're talking about research animals. Or the purpose of research. Does it matter if my research is done for the purposes of bettering humanity, or is it done just because I'm curious about it? Does that matter? I don't know. We should think about that. Historically, it has mattered. I'm going to show you some examples that it has mattered. But what I'm going to focus on mostly is the protection of human subjects from research. That's what most ethical review boards care about, is how much we as researchers take into consideration the wherewithal and protection of certain people that we research, in particular, vulnerable populations. I've heard that term a lot, it's a fascinating one. Vulnerable populations. What's a vulnerable population? Who's got an idea? How do you define? Give me an example of a vulnerable population.
Who may suffer certain kind of problems as an obstacle or
okay, give me an example.
For example,
prisoners, okay. Transgender people. Why are they vulnerable? Okay, excellent. You're thinking on multiple levels. That's fantastic. The classic ones tend to be Aboriginal populations. Why are they vulnerable? Because of power differentials, right? Are children vulnerable? Absolutely, children vulnerable. Even if the subject of the research is, I'm going to interview some children and ask them, I don't know, did they eat this morning? It's a nutritional study. It doesn't sound very dangerous, but they're vulnerable. Why is that? What do you think about it. Don't ask them. Think about it. The obvious example would be something like, I'm doing a study on survivors of sexual assault, rape victims, right? So if I'm going to ask them questions about their assault, I'm victimizing them again. So they're vulnerable to this kind of thing. That's a classic example. I want you to realize that vulnerability comes in many shapes and forms. So today we're going to cover the history of medical ethics in particular, because medical ethics is how we get health ethics, and this is supposedly a health issue, supposedly. We're going to have a broader discussion on global health ethics, and then we're going to look at the roles of the Research Ethics Board, which is going to really confound and define much of the work we end up doing as research professionals, something that we all have to manage as professors and scientists. So, the first question I want to ask you is, what is research? Can you give me a broad definition of what constitutes research? Is that? Privilege, not a right. Okay, that's a very convenient political correct definition. But how about if I'm asking you questions, am I doing research? Is this research? Yeah, I would say so. How about if a reporter stops, a journalist stops you on the street and says, what do you think about the elections this past week? Is that research? What about if the government conducts a census? Is that research? Okay, all these options are issues, but not everyone is subject to research ethics board. But we all supposedly and hopefully are subject to the grander rules of ethical behavior. That many people can do research. Research can be conducted by individuals, by governments, by institutions, and so forth. Corporations. We've already covered what's a vulnerable population. Why do we need ethical guidelines? Well, I'll tell you. We need ethical guidelines because it helps us ensure that our activities are ethical and moral. Ethics and morality are subtly different things, or not. If you ask senior ethicists around the world to define the difference between ethics and morality, they can't. So don't even bother trying to think about that. But we need guidelines to help us navigate this rough path to make sure that we are doing as ethical work as we can, also to conform to the laws of our country, and with the assumption that the laws and guidelines of our country are well correlated with the values of our society. What are the values of our society? What hopes the values of our society include protecting the rights of the vulnerable and respecting the rights of the individual. Okay, it was, you go back to before I show you that slide, the slide gives away the answer. There was a study that was done in Canada a while back. They interviewed a bunch of medical students who were doing their clinical practices in poor countries. They went to Haiti, Jamaica, places like that for a couple months. And they asked them the major reason they went to these countries. Do you have any idea what the major reason was? These are the medical students from wealthy countries going to poor countries. What do you think the major reason they went? Most people would say they're going because they want to have a different experience, want to see diseases perhaps that they didn't see elsewhere. The real reason was they want to be able to do procedures they wouldn't be allowed to do in the rich countries. Isn't that horrifying? That's horrible. Automatically, they're creating a divide between the rights of their society and the rights of other people. Now, I give them credit for being honest, saying that's the motivation. I teach medical students about in Canada. I see this attitude all the time, trying to beat it out, but it takes a while. And then you can justify this by saying, well, if I go abroad and I do these things to these people, I will become a better doctor. And when I come back, I will be able to give greater care to more people. There are easy ways to justify unethical work. So that's one of the traps you're trying to avoid, is trying to find a rationalization to justify means. The ends don't justify the means. Okay, let's look at the history of ethics and medical research. You've all heard Edward Jenner, right? Edward Jenner created the first viable vaccine for smallpox, and he did it back, I forgot the year, so long ago. But people don't realize the way he tested it. He tested a little boy named James Phipps, who's 8 years old. James Phipps worked in his garden. He was a lower class boy. Edward Jenner was a gentleman, high class gentleman. What he did was he gave James Phipps the vaccine that he created and then exposed him to smallpox and locked him away in a room to see what would happen. After a few days, James Phipps was not dead, so he knew the vaccine worked. And he took him out and gave him a shiny coin for his toys. But history records Edward Jenner as being a hero because he created this life-saving vaccine. And a sense of James Phipps. But at the time, his activities were seen as being ethical. Because at the time, if you were of a low social standing, you did not have the same rights as someone of a high social standing. Now today we see this as being important. We wouldn't do this today officially. But this is kind of what we see on a global level. We have people of privilege and people of not privilege, lesser classes or status. James Phipps is a metaphor, you could argue, for vulnerable people, or a metaphor for the developing world, the low income countries. And Edward Jenner is a metaphor for rich companies, drug companies, things like that. So I want to remember this example as being indicative of a fundamental problem in medical research efforts. In the 30s, it's a very famous study done in the US called the Tuskegee Syphilis Study. And this was done on black soldiers. They were told that they were being tested for bad blood. Remember that? It doesn't mean anything. It's a meaningless phrase. And in fact, they're being exposed to syphilis. And they weren't told this. And many of them died of syphilis, one that survived and long-lasting complications. So this is seen as a landmark moment in US medical ethics history where they did an inherently unethical thing to these poor people to learn something about biology. This is a landmark study. It really changed how they wrote about ethics and legislation later. In the 40s, the U.S. government was doing all kinds of secret studies on the effects of radiation on people without telling them. In fact, they exposed pregnant women to radiation without telling them. And this actually continued maybe into the 80s, I'm telling you short. So from the U.S. government, other governments have a long history of unethically experimenting on people. That takes us to the Nuremberg trials. Who's heard of the Nuremberg trials before? Most of you have heard. So I'll tell you briefly. At the end of World War II, the Nazis had been defeated, And so we put on trial. The ones that we thought committed war crimes were put on trial in Nuremberg, Germany. Now, probably aware the Nazis were experimenting on people. They did horrible things. I don't give you too many examples. One of them was they see how long it takes to kill a man by beating his testicles. And that's not a fun thing to do, obviously. And so they're put on trial, and the lawyers have to develop something called the Nuremberg Code, which was a kind of behavioral guideline for what constitutes a proper medical behavior in order to judge the scientists that were conducting these sort of things. And in general, the key phrase in the Nuremberg Code was the voluntary consent of the human subject is essential. That's the first time we have this idea that you must volunteer to be a subject. Prior to this, as you saw, we just did things. Now, for the first time ever, we're thinking, it's important that people have autonomy in their decision. The other aspect of the Nuremberg Code was that there has to be a reason to do the experiment. Is there a reason to beat a man to death on his testicles? There's no reason. So now, for the first time, we're saying, if you're going to do these experiments, there must be a long-term endpoint that's going to be beneficial to society itself. Still, it wasn't included in law. It was just a series of guidelines for the legal decisions. So another famous U.S. case was the Willowbrook State School. This was a school for mentally challenged people. And they started doing illegal hepatitis experiments on these individuals. Why then? Because they couldn't tell people that they're mentally handicapped. They can't communicate to the caregivers. Horrible story. This is probably the, trying to get the right word here, the ideal landmark case for how not to treat a vulnerable population. In fact, it's taking advantage of a very vulnerability in order to do these sort of things. So I can go on endless examples. So we take this to the 1960s, where for the first time, legislators got together to try to develop almost law. I say almost law because we have guidelines, not really law. The Declaration of Helsinki was signed in 1964 by members of the World Medical Association. That's several countries are signatories to the World Medical Association. And essentially, what the Declaration did was it enshrined this idea of autonomy. That in order for you to be part of my research project, I must explain to you why I'm doing it, the benefits that you will gain from it, the risks that you take with part of this experiment, and then you have the choice of whether or not to do it. It's kind of easy to visualize this for strictly medical interventions. For example, I have this new pill. This pill may cure your headache, but you have a small chance of losing all your hair. I'll take this chance. It's more difficult if we're talking about psychological interventions, because psychology has a long history of lying to the patients, deceiving the patients. We don't know if a therapy is going to work unless we're actively lying to the patient. Or randomized controlled trial. In a randomized controlled trial, testing a drug, one group will get the drug, another group will get placebo, something doesn't work. Right? So the group is getting the placebo, they're not going to get any benefit whatsoever. So this is kind of a slippery slope. We accept that a randomized controlled trial is ethical if it conforms to some of these guidelines, but there's an element of deception. And I think other people are going to talk a bit more about randomized controlled trials, particularly in the Indian case. Later on, we have the Belmont Report. The Belmont Report was another U.S. document. And it's the first time ever the United States put forth guidelines for ethical treatment of human subjects. And it essentially enshrined three ideas. Respect for people, meaning you can make choices. Beneficence. What is it? Beneficence. Means you're trying to do good. It seems obvious, but that's actually a landmark moment in legal history. Where we're saying, if you're going to do research on something, your ultimate goal is to do good for them, or for people like them, or for the world in general. The Nazis, their goal was not to do good. So now we have to try, the goal must be to do good. That's the justice. Justice, I'll talk about in a second. Justice is a totally difficult topic to consider. So that takes us to what I call the pillars of medical ethics. I'm skipping through a lot of history. But as a result of some of those declarations, medical students are taught about five pillars of medical ethics, which are also the basis for general global health ethics. The first is autonomy. Autonomy means that I must respect my subject's free will. If they want to be a part of this research project, they want to leave, if you leave. Even after you start, if you want to leave, you can leave. You have free will. But ever since I've talked about it already, you have to be willing or wanting to do good. That must be your goal at all times. Non-limitants who try not to do bad seems obvious. That has to be enshrined in our guidelines. Part of our goal in doing research is I'm going to try my best not to hurt you. Justice. Okay, justice is a topic. Justice has a particular role in some countries at the European courts. Canada is very big on justice. New Zealand is very big on justice. USA opens the books on the law. I'm not sure about the looking at it. But justice is simply this. It's you try and treat everyone the same. How does that manifest in research? Well, let's say I'm going to do a study on a new drug that I've created that makes you smarter. I'm going to try it out on the students of this university. So I'm going to select 20 students here to take this new drug to see if you get smarter. Now, the requirements of justice will ask, why did I choose this university? Why not JMU in Delhi? Why not Sri Chitra in Trivandrum? Why this one? Why are they not worthy of the good that my drug can offer? What's so special about you? And so a justice requirement asks me to consider, am I being fair to all the possible people I could have selected? It's a difficult thing to ask. And very often in ethical review submissions, we have to justify why we chose this particular population. More about justice here. So here's a quote about justice. There must be fair procedures and outcomes in selection of subjects, both individually and socially. So how I select the subject of my experiment must be well laid out and transparent and easily interrogated by people who are watching the process. So, one more quote about this. This is from the Canadian government standards on research, which are the equivalent of most countries. No segment of the population should be unfairly burdened with the harms of research. And conversely, no segment must be unfairly benefited by the benefits of research. So, when we talk about beneficence and non-maleficence, doing good, trying not to do bad, we are looking at risk. And risk is a difficult thing to think about. When I say risk in research, what do you think? Give me an example of risk that you might encounter in research. Again, let's say I'm doing a study of this drug that will make you smarter. What's the risk here?
Some side effects.
Side effects, obviously. Side effects of losing your hair. That's the obvious risk. And very often in medical research, we only focus on the physiological risk. But there are social risks also. Maybe if you get smarter, your friends won't like you. That's a risk we didn't consider. Maybe if you get smarter, you won't be happy in your program anymore. You want more for yourself. And then you'd be unhappy because maybe you can't afford to go to medical school. Whatever it might be. In my research, I work on, one of the things I work on is what's called reproductive tourism. Reproductive tourism, I'll talk about this next week. That's when foreigners come to a country like India and hire women here to have babies for them. Right? So their contracts, the sort of contracts, are fairly robust. Well, not all of this, but very often, fairly robust. Meaning that the risks have been well defined. If you get pregnant, you have a risk of having a miscarriage, having high blood pressure, but they never talk about the social risks. If you get pregnant by a foreign client, will your husband still like you? Will your village still accept you? Will your body be damaged such that she won't be attracted to other men? All these different things you can think about. And there are social and emotional risks that are not encapsulated very often in the informed consent contract. So risk is a complicated subject. And we don't spend a lot of time thinking about it. Now, the WHO, the World Health Organization, has an ethics office. They only opened this ethics office 10 years ago, 13 years ago. It only gives guidelines, though, for projects that they themselves have developed and overseen. However, if you're looking for more guidance for global health research, that's a place to start. That's some guidelines. Let's talk about informed consent. Do you have the show House here? House of the Indian Nations? Okay, you do. So you know that. Okay, who has seen the show? Your wife has seen the show. Very often, House in the show. He's a doctor in a hospital. He's a brilliant doctor, but he's a curmudgeon. He's not very nice. And he comes, and his patients come, and he doesn't like his own patients. And very often, he will tell his doctors, go and get informed consent from that patient so that I can save their life. Do you see the problem with the way he's phrased that? Go and get informed consent. Otherwise, I can't save his life.
It's a kind of forced informed consent.
Forced informed consent. There's arrogance underlying it. See, I know better. I know this patient needs to do this. So just get him out of my way so I can do this thing that I want to do. In other words, the patient here has become a barrier to doing research, rather than having the informed consent process be part of the entire journey that I'm undertaking to progress. Now, in this case, we're talking about therapy, and I'm talking about research. But they're kind of the same. In research, we're doing interventions. We're intervening in a population, changing them somewhat. That's kind of like the therapy. So Wikipedia defines informed consent as a legal condition in which a person can be set for giving consent based upon an appreciation and understanding of the facts. Keywords there are appreciation and understanding. So can you think of some of the factors that may prevent appreciation and understanding?
Lengthy documentation.
Documentation?
Lengthy documents and explanations.
Okay, there it is. Yeah, that's part of it. How about some characteristics on the part of the patient or the subject that may prevent appreciation and understanding?
Literacy or different language.
Perfect. Literacy, different language, education levels in general. If I'm giving you a list of, oh, you may suffer from hyperthyroidism and preeclampsia, all these words that maybe this person has no idea what they are. They speak English fairly well, but these are words they don't know. That's not fair. Sorry.
Same thing also,
what
if you're using lay language?
I'm using lay language, yeah. True. But very often there isn't a lay language for some reason. Now think about it more complicated. If we're dealing with a cross-cultural event, as we often do with global health research, it's almost impossible to get full understanding. Because there are cultural constructs that underlie language. Even me talking to a somewhat different culture, so some of the words that I use may mean something a little bit different from me. The word love means different things to different people, for example. What about if you think about a poor Indian woman from the village who's illiterate, who is being treated by a British white male doctor. And he says, here's this treatment that I want you to take. Do you consent to it? And he does his best to explain to her. Is there a factor historically, sociologically, economically, that may prevent her from fully expressing consent?
Language and culture.
Language is one.
Cultural diversity.
Socioeconomic background. Historically, how about the historical context? You have the former colonial power representing all of the power and knowledge and wealth and privilege.
Color
of skin. All these things. So it's possible to compel consent simply by being a certain person. Is that truly informed consent? It's complicated. There's no perfect way to do this. We have to be aware all the time of the kinds of dynamics that prevent true appreciation of risk. Exactly. The example I gave you before, sorbacy. So let's say we have here a village woman from India who has agreed to be a surrogate mother. She signed the contract. So that means this. Are there factors that may cause you to suspect that maybe she is not really consenting, that maybe she's being coerced in some way? How may she be coerced? Think of an example. Economically. What do you mean by that?
She's made a lot of money and she needs the money first.
Okay, that's very good. So at some point, the economic carrot has outweighed her own moral visions. How else should I be coerced? Can I truly trust when she signs that paper that this is her will? This is what she wants to do. It's
rightly knowing that we will not, there is no other option for it, for it.
Yeah,
we're going for that.
We'll cover that in a second. It's amazing, you guys get that right away. When I talk about this in the West, it takes them forever to understand that. You guys understand that right away. One of the things that comes up often here is that sometimes women are actually fronts for other people. So it's their husband who wants the money, or their mother-in-law wants the money or something, and they decide because their family wants them to. But we as researchers have to respect the autonomy of the individual, not necessarily the surroundings. But all those other things are true as well. So this brings us to the point we raised. What is choice really? At what point does autonomy become exploitation? Here's three obvious examples. Prostitution. Prostitution, one could argue, is an expression of autonomy. I own my body. I will sell services for my body as I please. Who are you to tell me otherwise? That's why I love it. On the other hand, if the only alternative to selling your body is starvation, is that really choice? And if someone takes advantage of that choice, is that not exploitation? So very often we deal with really vulnerable populations in a research context. We have to be careful that we're not exploiting their desperation in such a way that they would otherwise not want to take part in. Other examples here, something called organ tourism. This is where people go to countries to buy organs, like kidneys. Kidneys are very valuable things. So an American, for example, who's dying of kidney failure, desperately needs a kidney, can't get it. So he goes to Vietnam and pays $10,000 to a village boy in Vietnam for his kidney. $10,000 to the American is not a lot of money. It's a life-changing amount of money for the Vietnamese. Would he have given it otherwise, not given the money? Top of the money. He's desperate. So he gave up his very valuable part of his life. So in other words, part of the problem doing development work in the abroad for the vulnerable populations is very often we only see the immediate ethical requirements, meaning I only need you to sign a piece of paper saying you consent to this. Whereas there's a larger conversation we had around how they got to that point in the first place. What are the factors that have compelled them to sign that piece of paper? Are there cultural, economic, gender, language, historic, colonial issues that may have compelled us to go? So if we only rely on informed consent for ethical guidance, we could be blinded to this tension that I mentioned between autonomy and exploitation. So, in India, we all know about microcredit. It's a very big thing. It still is. And when I talk about this in the West, people take a while to understand what the problem is. So they see microcredit. Anyone knows what microcredit is? Microfinance? No. So for a long time, it was considered to be the great savior of the impoverished world. Now we can bring people out of poverty with small amounts of money invested in just the right people. But tell me, what happened to microcredit? What are the horror stories of microcredit?
High interest rates
that cause people to go into further debt. So we have epidemics of debt suicides in this country, like thinking of Nepal as well, places like that. The cycles of debt that are being exacerbated. Well, very often, we have the same situation where the women who receive the money, very often it is women who receive the money, are fronts for their husbands or for other family members. And the money is being used to pay off other debts, not being used to invest in the businesses that they agree to. Food aid is a popular example of development efforts. So, let's say there is a famine in North Africa, and they're desperately in need of food. What is wrong with just shipping lots of food in? This happened, right? Back in the 70s and 80s, this was a big thing. There were lots of famines around the world, and the Western countries in particular were raising lots of money to collect food and ship it to these countries. It was a bad thing. Why was it a bad thing?
The kind of food that was being sent is not necessarily needed by the
applicants. Okay, so it's cultural appropriateness. That's one.
There is no system in place to manage the distribution.
Very good. So what happens to food?
It gets wasted.
Oh, what happens? What happens to it?
Sold.
It gets sold.
Yeah.
It gets co-opted by other powers. And one very surprising economic effect first, the local is made private property. This is where the poor distribution comes. It's not uncommon to see local warlords in some of these countries will steal the food and then resell it to sustain their enterprises. So what began as an altruistic food donation is now a mechanism for funding war. That's not what we intended. Or we undermine local food production economy. Even in places of famine, there are still people producing food and selling it. And so if you suddenly show up with lots of free food, they are going out of business and they will never recover. Now you have a permanent state of dependence in the society. So in many places now, they will say, do not send us food. Send us other kinds of economic aid such that we can lead people or indigenous or local food production process. It's not black and white. And the other things you mentioned, the appropriateness and so forth.
So the community to, for example, they stop being proactive in developing themselves.
Exactly right.
They make a lot of funding.
This is one of the criticisms. I'm not sure if true it is, that's definitely one of the criticisms. And B.C. Moyo, the famous Nigerian economist, is, you know, saying these things. I have a problem with it, but I think she's on something when it comes to this. So, there are two poles of thought when it comes to thinking about global health crises, how to deal with that. Very often when we respond to a global health crisis, even with all the research projects, we end up doing more harm. So in the case of food, we show that lots of food, lots of good intentions, we end up doing more harm. So again, when I send my students abroad, I make sure they understand that distinction. I like to think about it as a continuum between two poles. At one pole we have ethical paralysis, the other, righteous seizure. What are these things? Righteous seizure is when you are so consumed wanting to do good, wanting to help this person, to help the society, see that suffering ended, is that nothing will prevent you from being there. You are seized with the need to intervene, such that you will perceive maybe your intervention is slightly unethical, or may have unethical activities down the line. On the other hand, when you stop to think about it, you start seeing the problems that your intervention is producing. For example, if I'm sending food to Uganda in 1985, their family, I would have stifled their local food production economy. Somebody says, oh, I can't send food. I'm paralyzed. I don't know what to do. Ethical paralysis. Nothing is perfectly ethical, so I can't do anything. I don't know what to do. Every step I take causes problems. I don't know what to do. Righteous seizure. I have to do something now. It doesn't matter what it is. I have to do something then. Produce hand on it. So when my teams go abroad, I want them to be somewhere over here. Once we have planned out our project, I want us to realize that not everything is perfectly ethical. We don't be as ethical as we can. I want to give you an example of a righteous seizure. This guy. Who knows who this is? Okay. Everyone is so young, you don't remember him. His name is Bob Geldof, and he was a very minorly successful rock star in the 1970s in England. And in the 1980s, he saw the family have a little bit of He decided he needed to do something right now. It's good for him, which is passionate and a large help. So he raised a lot of money. He wrote a song called Do They Know It's Christmas? Is the famous song. And all these other countries started making their own Christmas songs. And these songs all produced money that was turned into food that was sent to Africa. And all that money was squandered and wasted. And he ultimately started a concert called Live Aid 1989. It was the world's biggest concert. It was simulcast around the world simultaneously. It raised, I think, $1 billion. And was squandered again, not spent in the right way, in my opinion. He has a learning lesson. So most recently, he was talking about Ebola and saying things about Ebola and not very bad. He doesn't go from 2005. Something must be done, anything must be done, whether it works or not. That's a classic case of righteous seizure, whether it works or not. If it doesn't work, don't do it. If something must be done, perhaps something must be done, ethical thing must be done, not just anything. Bob Geldof, by the way, he's multi-millionaire. So this is an example of righteous seizure. So, more problems I'm going to tell you. When we look at why a Western country, for example, should be intervening in a low-income country to do global health, I like to think about two models. The first is the humanitarian model, and the second is the political model. And essentially this. The humanitarian model holds that all peoples are equal. Everyone is deserving of care and of respect. And so, of course, if we see suffering, we need to go and put together a team and intervention and see if we can help. The political model holds that we, as people of privilege, whether it's in this country or abroad, we are certain economic status of privilege, are probably to blame to some extent because of the nature of our economic system. Particularly true for colonial countries or colonial master countries, or to colonial countries. Therefore, if we are partly to blame, maybe it's our duty to do what we can. Again, I encourage my teams to gravitate towards this. I don't know which one is correct. I know that this one allows us to be a bit more humble. And we're less likely to be arrogant and feeble, and less likely to create ethical transgressions. I'm going to show you examples after the break. I'm going to ask you some questions. Okay, so, give me time for this. So, here's a couple of funny situations I'm looking at. Let's say you were doing a research project or some kind of intervention in a low-income environment, maybe a tribal society. You show up with drugs, life-saving drugs, and the society needs. You don't have enough for everyone. How are you going to decide who gets it? So the ones who are most need. How do you define a need? Who's a need? There are two ways of doing it. You can say the ones who are the most ill, or you can say the ones who are most likely to be affected. Or you can say the children. Or you can say the men, because you made them better than the work. Right? Or you can say the women, because they take care of children. So obviously when you start looking at the criteria for deciding who is most in need, it gets very complicated very fast. Your values start coming. In medicine, luckily, we have long-standing traditions of triage, what constitutes triage. But for things that aren't obviously medical, very complicated, very complex. I have a solution, except to say that before you go, you must decide these things. There's some plans in place that are principled and well thought out. Second, you provide great care when you're in the field that you have to leave. So let's say you go to one of these struggling societies or communities, and maybe you're teaching children, maybe you are giving medical care, maybe you're something. And they learn to rely on you. Now your time is up. Your degree is finished. You have to leave now. Is it ethical to leave? Here are the two schools of thought. One school of thought says, yeah, you did your part. Before you, there was no care. Now you can leave because you gave them something that was not there before. The other school of thought says, no, it's not ethical because you created a dependence. Now you're taking away the thing that you have. You make it worse because of it. I don't know which one is correct. I do know that by my definition of ethical behavior, being responsible for foreseeable consequences of your actions, this gets very interesting. Is it foreseeable that you're going to create a hole in the leader? Yes, it was. Therefore, you're responsible for two people. Be aware, as I mentioned, you are responsible for foreseeable consequences of your actions. Is it therefore simply to do your best? No, it's not, in my opinion. If you're doing your best, it's not good enough. Then you don't do your best. Try something else. Try a new profession. Right, so. Can you explain that thought? Alright, so. Let's talk a little bit about research ethics for us now. In most countries, when you put forth a project, by what's called the research ethics. Sometimes they're called RUPs, research ethics boards, or sometimes they're called institutional reviews or IRBs. It's their job to make sure that your work is ethical according to these standards of the exam. There's a certain overall global standard of ethicalness when it comes to all animals. In Canada, and most countries, they don't have the force of law. So if you don't do this, you're not going to do it. What will happen, though, is that your institution probably will lose some funding from the government. That's why it's an obvious reason for it. Journalists don't have research boards. Corporations don't have research boards. That's why they get away with doing things that are considered ethical. There's no one receiving it. Okay? So these are the kinds of institutions that do have ethics boards. Universities, which is those that have ethics. So I mentioned vulnerable populations are against the copyright. Why do you care? You care because it's the right thing to do. You care because the more ethical you are, the more the community that you deal with is going to buy into your project. You care because your funding might depend on it. You care because your institutions might depend on it. And you also care because now a lot of journals won't publish your work unless you show that your work has been connected by these research ethics. I highly advise you seek research ethics for independent research. In general, you have two kinds of research: primary collection of data and secondary collection. Secondary collection of data, or secondary analysis of it, is when the data already exists somewhere. You're just taking that data and you're analyzing it. So maybe there's an NGO that interviews some people about it. They're going to send you those interviews to your first panel and analyze it. That's secondary.
Is it necessary to take the ethical permission of secondary data or analysis?
Yes, that's good. We'll get to that in a second. Primary collection, that's when you yourself are going out to collect the information. You're going to interview people, or you're going to measure people, and take blood samples. Primary collection obviously has a higher bar to go over. This has a lower bar. The secondary data that the ethics application usually consists of some kind of indication of permission between people who own the data, indicating how they collected it and how you will be using it. And then your application often says, this is how I'm going to protect the privacy that this data discusses. The primary is a lot more involved. It's how we're going to protect the privacy of people, how we're going to make sure there's autonomy, how we're going to make sure there's informed consent, what we're going to do if they decide to leave, what we're going to do if someone has a nervous breakdown. All these things have to be considered. That's why this is so much easier. And there are ways of cheating, too. I'm not going to show you this way of cheating, but we can talk about that later on. Yeah, so here's, I mentioned, secondary analysis. What we're looking for is, you know, what data are you going to use? How was it collected? Was it ethical? How do you prove it was ethical? Can't really, except with a letter from the curriculum of quality. They have to trust they know what's going on. And how are you going to make sure that people's privacy was taken care of? So for example, if I get data from an NGO who's interviewed some people, I have their names, I have all their measurements here, maybe I'm asking about their sexual life. Do they cheat on their spouses and things like that? I'm going to publish this advocating their names out because I want their friends coming up and being under their eyes. So I have to show throughout this application I'm going to protect their privacy by removing their names and replacing their name with numbers. These are more considerations. Okay, back to this of the year. For this, I ended up later on getting ethics permission for this exact thing. The way I did it was, even though I owe the NGO, I took my name off of the letter and the other owners wrote me a letter saying they gave me permission to use it. It became a secondary analysis of the ethics application. That's sneaky. It's probably not the best thing to do, but it's legal. That's what we did. I showed you as an example of some of the bad things that research is doing in the ethics application. If you understand what I did, we'll talk about it later on. This is the letter that we're doing. So I'm moving faster now. When you submit an ethics review, in general, it contains these issues. Told the wrong ones. But the big ones are how you're going to collect your data, how you're going to analyze your data, what the people are required to do. Are you going to ask them questions? Are you going to take blood samples? Are you going to do tests? Are there going to be any effects on them, like physical effects or psychological effects? You should care about that. But also, how the data is going to be stored. So it's not so much what we're going to do with the people, but once I get the data, I'm going to keep it in my records of order, I'm going to make it better. Indian government does not have one. There are states in India that don't have research on these books. I do research in Andhra Pradesh, and we have a hard time finding research on these books. We have to make our own actually. There are actually commercial research on these books, companies that function as research on these books. I don't advise you to do this, but you really, really have to.
It sounds like a shame. Right?
You're better off other solutions we can talk about. Okay, so I'm not going to do this. This is going to be a draft test later. But right now, exactly what I have. Perfect. We're going to take a break now.